As usual, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our little deed from us, inshallah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the mukhlaseen, those who are sincere, inshallah. Those who come here to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over our hearts. Where does Allah look at? Al-Qulub. Allah looks at the hearts. Allah is watching over the hearts. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us ikhlas. Okay? Now hopefully, inshallah, you came here to learn your deen. Hopefully, you came here to learn and get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hopefully, we came here so that we can enlighten ourselves and learn from the sunnah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah ta'ala, I hope that is the reason you are here for. We don't have any wealth. Are we distributing any money in the masjid? Do you find any money? Are we distributing any money? Anyone getting money? Anyone getting richer? No, we don't get rich. We don't distribute no money here. But we are distributing what? What are we distributing? Knowledge. We are distributing the inheritance of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What did we inherit from him? What's the inheritance left behind for us by the Prophet? Huh? Knowledge, yes. Warrathul ilm. Innama warrathul ilm. The anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they never left behind dirham or dinar. There is no wealth. They never left behind any money. Okay? Worldly possessions, they never left behind. Because they were not busy collecting this. So there's nothing for them to leave behind. Our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever some sort of sadaqah came to him, or whenever money and wealth came to him, he would distribute it within that night. If he got any money, what would he do with that money? What would he do with it? Distribute it in that same night. He didn't want to have any possession from this life. He used to give it out to the poor and needy. He would call the muhajirin, call the ansar, and give to everyone who asks them. He was very charitable, alayhi salatu wassalam. But what did he leave behind? Huh? Knowledge. He left behind knowledge. And we need to inherit that knowledge. And where do we learn that knowledge from? In the masajid. Fi buyutillah. In the bait of Allah. In the house of Allah. In the most place that is loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The most dearest place of Allah on this face of this earth is where? The masajid of Allah. The masajidullah. This is the most place that Allah loves. Where do we love most? Our bedrooms? Ah. Where do we love first? Inshallah, we love the where? The masjid. We should love the masjid, number one. From amongst those who Allah will shade them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. سَبْعَةٌ يُضِلِّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ذِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ On Yawm al-Qiyamah, there is heat. The sun will be brought what? Close. The sun that we see now, that is so far, will be brought very close to our heads, and people will be sweating on that day, and they will be under the heat of that sun. Except seven characteristics of people, seven types of people. Amongst those seven types of people who would not experience the heat of the sun on Yawm al-Qiyamah, where would they be sitting? Which shade? There's no tree. Yeah, there's trees in Jannah, but this is before Jannah. Huh? Allah's throne, yes. The shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can see the status that these people have. Well, everyone that Allah has created since Adam alayhi salam to the last man on Yawm al-Qiyamah, Hufatul Urah. They are naked and they are barefooted. You will be selected on Yawm al-Qiyamah the way you were born. You might be thinking, why? People have no time to look around. The problems of Yawm al-Qiyamah is very extreme. Everyone is scared for himself. There is no time for people to look around at each other. Everybody is worried for himself. On that day, there are seven categories of people that will be sitting under the shade of Allah. They will be sheltered and they are peacefully waiting for the Qiyamah to start. Amongst them is what? Who knows what? Can you know some of them? MashaAllah. Rajulun, a man. قلبه معلق بالمساجد. A man or a young man whom his heart is attached to the masjid. Look at the hadith expressions. They don't say a man who comes to the masjid. No, he is someone who is attached to the masjid. You can't separate him and the masjid. He's constantly at the masjid. You'll find him at every salah in the masjid. The masjid is his place. He will leave and his heart is left behind where? In the masjid. His heart is in the masajid. He goes out to college and he's thinking of the next salah to come and pray in the masjid. He goes out to work and all he can think about is the next salah and when is he going to go out to the masjid again. He goes out to his family and all he's thinking about is when he's going to return back to the masjid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevated him because why? Because he loved to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because these are places where you come and meet what? You meet Allah. This is the beautullah. This is the house of Allah. Whenever you come to the masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invites you to the masjid. Invites you to the masjid. It's like a meal, a preparation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the host. He's a guest and we are the? He's a guest or you are the guest? We are the guest. And who the host? Allah is the host. This is the bait, the bait of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is where iman is distributed. This is where the barakah is distributed. This is where the ajr and the reward are distributed. This is where sitting is only... Just sitting here now, we are in salah. You can't get this at home. Sitting in the masajid is like what? Praying. Exactly like praying. It's as if you are in salah. Subhanallah. 1 hour that we're here today, we'll get the reward of what? As if we have been praying salah in this masajid. You can't get this reward at home. So you need to compete the masajid. Huh? Last week you didn't come. Did you regret it? Did you think about it? Yeah. Was it painful? Very. Inshallah. Yeah. Hopefully. When you miss the masjid, one day you should say, Subhanallah. Huh? You shouldn't be saying, Alhamdulillah, today I take a break from that ma'allin who only shouts, that's all he knows. Huh? MashaAllah. So welcome to the bait of Allah. Welcome to the beauty of Allah. Welcome to places where the barakat is earned, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah ta'ala, we will discuss the rewards of these halaqat, inshallah ta'ala. We were looking at the topic of being proud of who you are, being proud of Islam, isn't it? Being proud of being Muslim. Being proud of being Muslim. Okay? Being proud of your religion. Be proud of your identity. Have unique identity. We said Islam encourages its followers to stand out from the crowd. To stand out where? Stand out from where, Hussein? From the crowd. You have to be different to the crowd. You need to be different to your classmates. You need to stand out so that they can say, this is a Muslim. Why is he different to us? How come he does not follow our trends? How does he not follow our fashions? Why does he not dress like us? Why does he not talk like us? Why does he not behave like us? Why is he different? What does he have that he's proud of? So your character and who you are should be a magnet inviting people to Islam. Yes or no? So you have to be proud. But to be proud of Islam, you have to know what you have. You can't be proud of what you are unless you know what you have. So you need to understand and value Islam. What do we need to do? Value Islam. How precious is gold? What's the most precious stones? Huh? Isha Gade. La ilaha illallah. This guy is a different world. That's what too much chemistry does to you. He studied too much chemistry classes. But put him like that, Isha. Gold. Huh? Diamond. Pearls. Yes? Imagine if you give a gold to a child. What would he do to it? Huh? You give it a gold to a child. What would he do to it? I put it in his mouth, exactly. They don't understand the value. Does that mean the gold is not valued, or the person does not know the value of what he has? The person doesn't know the value. So it's two things. Islam is the best religion, but when the Muslim who's carrying this message does not understand the value of what he has, and you will be valued by people according to what you have and how much you know of your religion. So we need to understand the value of this religion, the beauty of Islam, the completeness of this religion, inshallah ta'ala. And then when you value Islam, you value what you have, and then you value who you are. And then you behave, and then you behave accordingly. When you value Islam, then you behave what? Accordingly. When you are, for example, from the people who memorize the Quran, from those who Allah honored them by the Taj. You know what's Taj? The crown. When Allah crowns you because you are Hamil al-Quran, you are a carrier of the Quran. When Allah has honored you by being someone who knows and who memorizes His words, the words of Allah, subhanallah, kalamullah, when Allah has honored you this, is it befitting for you to sit along and people who waste their time, people that listen to music, if you sit alongside them and you are a carrier of the Quran, what happens to the value of the Quran? Diminishes. People will disrespect the Quran because you are not respecting the Quran that you hold. So it's not befitting someone who's holding the Quran, who memorizes the Quran, to be in certain gatherings, to be in certain places. Because then he is lowering down the value of what? Lowering the value of himself and lowering the value of what? Of what he carries. And you are only valued based on what values you have. Yes or no? Everyone is valued according to what? His values. What are your values? Who dictates for you your values? Islam dictates for you. When you honor yourself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will honor you. And then when Allah honors you, Allah will put your love in the heart of Jibreel alayhi salam. Allah will tell Jibreel, Allah loves so and so because he's a good Muslim. So Jibreel will start to do what? Love you. In a hadith, Jibreel will start to love you. And then when Jibreel loves you, he calls to the angels, and the angels will start to love you. When the angels love you, they will call to the people. Allah will place in the hearts of the people on this world your acceptance. So who valued you? Who controls the hearts of people? Who controls the hearts of people? When you go to a job interview and a lady is your interviewer and she extends her hand to you, what do you do? Sorry, mate. La ilaha illallah. A lady, ya sheikh. I didn't say man. Sorry, Miss Sahaka. Hey, yeah. She extends hand to you and now you think, subhanallah. Imagine this is a good job. And she's the manager of the company. Huh? COVID. Alhamdulillah. Thanks to COVID. Marka, this is where your iman is tested now. This is when you should say, you know what? Izzatul Muslim. My tawakkul is in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I should put reliance on my tawakkul in where? In Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wants me to get this job, I will get this job whether she likes it or not. Allah will make that pen write. Who controls her hearts? Who controls the pen that she writes with? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the aqeedah of the Muslim. So when you go to class and when you go to school, don't say, oh my friends, peer pressure. None of that stuff. None of that stuff. If you keep thinking of that stuff, that means there is something wrong with your aqeedah. Your belief is not correct. Alhamdulillah, you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but your weakness in your iman, there is weakness in your level of knowledge, in the level of your belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is weakness. And that is why we mentioned, you need to be unique. But to be unique, you have to be someone who's proud of who you are. To be proud of who you are, you have to know what you have, the value of Islam. So when you value Islam, you behave like a Muslim. You dress like a Muslim. You conduct your life like a Muslim. You only have friends that will only help you to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, we took as homework, remember? Which ayah was it? Ayah 43. 143. Okay, I will be checking your notes. I will be checking, inshallah. Ayah number 143, what was it? Who remembers the ayah? Read in English, inshallah. Did you guys write it down? Check your notes. وَكَذَلَكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. That ayah, we took that ayah. وَكَذَلَكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ. And thus we have made you, who? The Muslims. يَا أَتْبَاعَ مُحَمَّدٍ. All the followers of Muhammad عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. Jazakallah khair. And so we have made you what? A middle nation. أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. We said, Ibn Kathir said what? Wasata refers to? Did you guys write it down? Ibn Kathir, write it down. You guys are very lazy. Until I tell you to write, you never write. Where's your pens? Very good. Jazakallah khair. Write down. Maiza, where's the pen? You'll find one, inshallah. Ya akhi fadl? Best, mashallah. Allah yahfadhak, Shaykh. Jazakallah khair. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. And so we have made you. Who? Who is you? The Muslims. The followers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the followers of Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam. Those who have accepted Allah as their... What do we accept Allah as? As their Lord. Yes? رَضِيتُ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّا وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينَا وَمُحَمَّدٍ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ وَرَسُولَ وَرَسُولًا. Those who have accepted Islam as their religion and accepted Muhammad عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ as their prophet and Islam as their religion, Allah as their Lord. For them, this ayah is this. Allah says to them, you are the best of the ummah, or wasata, wasata. You are the middle ummah. And we said, Ibn Kathir said in his sharh, the best and most excellent. Write it down. Ibn Kathir, Qura. Okay, from the scholars of Tafsir. You have to learn the names of the scholars of Islam, inshallah. So Ibn Kathir said, in his commentary of this ayah, in the sharh of this ayah, wasata, middle ummah means, write down, muqartay. Ibn Kathir, muqartay. Barakallah. Ibn Kathir said, ummatan wasata means, people in Zoom expect you to write it down as well. Inshallah, those who are joining us from the Zoom, barakallahu fikum. I expect you also to take notes, inshallah. Jazakumullahu khayran. Ummatan wasata, a middle ummah. Ibn Kathir said in his commentary, wasata refers to the best and most excellent. Refers to the best and most excellent ummah. So you are number one or number two. Number one. Is there any nation better than this nation? No. There was a time when there were nations who were number one at their time. Yes? Each nation were good at their time. But now, since this is the last of the nations, this is the best of the ummah. This is the best nation ever raised. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ever raised on this earth. Not only we are the best, we are the most excellent, and we are al-wasat. There's other tafasir, other explanations of the word wasatan. We are the middle ummah. There's other meanings to the word middle, but this is one of the meanings, that you are the best and the most excellent nation. Who said this? Hussein. Huh? Ibn Kathir. Tha. Kathir maha. Tha. Kathir. Kathir, yes. Okay? Ibn Kathir, mashallah. وَكَذَلَكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Why? لِتَكُونُوا. Yes, complete. So that you may be. بارك الله فيك. لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. So that you may be witness over mankind. So there are two things we learn from this ayah. Two honors. Allah has honored this ummah. And when I say this ummah, you, I, your fathers, everyone who says La ilaha illallah, including yourself, you need to be proud of who you are. But to understand that, you have to understand what Allah has made you. Number one, you are the best of the nations. So is it befitting for someone who's the best of the nations to become a photocopy of other nations? Huh? Who copies who? The best copies the worst, or the worst copies the best? Exactly. When you are the number one, when you are the most excellent, when you are the most, you have the best religion, why do you have to copy and imitate other people in their lifestyle? Means you have problem in your brain. The Quran is complete and correct. It's either lack of knowledge, you don't understand what you have. Because remember what I told about the guy who has gold in his hands and he doesn't know what is the value of gold. What would he do with it? He would throw it, he would play like football, he would keep smashing it on the wall. He does not understand the value of what he has. Am I right? So when you have Islam and you are imitating other ways of life other than Islam, it means you don't understand the value of what you have. You are ignorant, jahil. You are ignorant of your religion. And that's why we're here today, to learn our religion. And you know who's worse than the jahil? Who's more worse than ignorant person? Huh? Shaitan, inshallah, good. good. There's no wrong answers here. He's better than you because you spoke up. Speak up, yes. Participate. Kada qosolka. Those who giggle and laugh, how long can we not? If you are a man, you have to be serious, inshallah. And the one who's ignorant than a jahil is what we call jahil murakkab. Jahil murakkab. I don't know how to do murakkab in English. Huh? Extensive jahil or. Yeah. He is the one who thinks he knows. Someone who knows his jahil, there's a cure for him, yes or no? If you know you're jahil, what's a cure to come to the masjid and learn? But imagine if you think you know, you're Mr. I know everything. But you know, you're jahil. He's worst. Why? There's no medicine for such person. Such person will sit in his house. Such person will waste his time watching TV. Such person will say, I have no time for the masajid, because he thinks he knows everything. He thinks he has Islam. He understands Islam. Yes or no? Whereas, when the more you come to the masjid, the more you learn, the more you discover you don't know nothing. Yes or no? The more you learn, the more you learn things that you haven't heard of before. Okay? And that's the value of ilm. That's the value of knowledge. Allah says, the ones who are knowledgeable are not like the ones who are ignorant. They're not the same. In the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are not the same. Those who have knowledge and those who have no knowledge. The man who killed the 99 people. Have you heard of his story? He killed 99 people. And then what happened to him? He said he went to a sheikh. Somebody else. He went to a scholar. No way. Huh? Abid. Barakallahu fiqh. What is abid? A worshipper. And what did the worshipper tell him? Before that. Huh? Barakallah fika akhi. Jazakallah khair for the tea. I didn't notice he gave me shy. He went to al-abid. And the worshipper said to him, you have no chance of what? No tawbah for you. 99 people you have killed. Who's going to forgive you? And then what did he do? He made him 100. He said, since I can't repent, what's the point of adding one more to my list? So he killed al-abid as well. And then after that he went, still there was still light of iman. Remember what I told you about the issue of the fitrah inside your heart, still there. The light is still, it's about to go off, but the light of iman is still there. The hope that he wants to repent is still there in this guy. Despite doing all the crimes, killing 100 men, still he wanted to come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he was not mutakabbir. He wasn't proud. He wanted to repent. So he came back the second time to who? A scholar. And the scholar said to him what? Yeah, he said, Barakallahu fi. He said, who can stand between you and tawbah? Who can stand between you and tawbah? No one can stand between you and tawbah. Go to such and such city where there are nice, good people worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go to them and Allah will forgive your sins. Yes or no? And then he went there, and as we know, the remaining of the story. But why did I mention the story? I mentioned the story to show you the difference between the alim and the abid. The ones who have knowledge, guidance, it's like the scholar. The ones who are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who's doing good, but he has no ilm. So when you have no ilm, this is a tool of shaitan against you. Yes or no? So imagine if you had no ilm, then you would not make any tawbah. But because of the knowledge, this imam or the sheikh saved this person from being, keep killing people. But that's the difference between learning ilm, having knowledge. So coming back to our ayah, وَكَذَلَكَ جَعَلْنَاكُ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ, so that you can become witness over what? Over mankind. So on يوم القيامة, this ummah, Allah has honored it by becoming what on يوم القيامة? Witness over who? Huh? All of mankind. How is this possible? How does that happen? Anyone who knows about it? Yes. Zakaria, Bismillah. Okay, Zakaria, mashallah. Yeah. I want your feedback, guys. Huh? I don't want you just to sit there, take notes. You know, because when the answer comes from you, hopefully, inshallah, it will stick in your brain. When I feed you everything, why did Allah, people in Zoom can participate. I will be able to see your writing, inshallah. Forgive me, I always try to concentrate on people sitting in front of me. But inshallah, from time to time, I see your answers. Forgive me, inshallah. Ah, this ummah is witness over the other nations. What does this mean? How are they witnessing over nations? And when will this happen? It's already happened. You have any idea? Huh? Do you know what I said? So do. Come close. Barakallahu feek. How can Kali? The closer you are, the closer you are to Jannah. So do. This is the mercy of Allah. Come closer to me. Barakallahu feek. Wait, Makashi. Did you hear what I just said? There's no shame in saying no. No, barakallahu feek. Hay hada digisu inshallah. We said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this ummah, which is you, I, and all the way to the sahaba, yes? The ummah of who? Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Yes or no? Which ummah are we talking about? Yes. The ummah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, the ummah of this risala, ummah al-risala, the ummah of this prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That's what we're talking about. Okay? And that is an honor for us, am I right? Yes or no? Barakallahu feek. How are they witness to the nations that have come before them? Okay, good try. Fadal akhi. Everything is try, we all try inshallah. Surah Nisa. Listen. Yes. Al haula shahida, yes. 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 Barakallah fi akhi. Forgive me if I'm not looking at you. It's because I'm trying to concentrate as well at the Zoom, trying to see what they type. Because really, Islamic manners is always to look at the person talking to you, okay? MashaAllah, Jazakallahu khairan. One person shared with us, saying, on the day of judgment, we will be witnessing for every ummah, even the ummah of Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. This is through the stories of the Quran. MashaAllah, all of your answers are correct, inshaAllah. There is a hadith of Rasulullah salam where he mentions that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, when every people will be brought and all the anbiya will be brought on Yawm al-Qiyamah, what will happen is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask every prophet if he has conveyed the message. Allah will ask Nuh alayhi salam, did you convey the message to your people? And Nuh will say yes. And Allah will ask his people, has Nuh conveyed the message to you? They will say, no, Nuh has not conveyed the message to us. Ibrahim, have you conveyed your message to your ummah? Yes, Ya Allah, I have. And Allah will ask the people of the followers of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Have Ibrahim conveyed their message? They will deny. Oh Musa, his people will deny. Ya Isa, his people will say, Ya Allah, he hasn't told us anything. Because on that day, people think they can lie, just like they used to lie in this dunya. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask the ummah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And when Allah will ask this ummah, has not Muhammad conveyed the message? No. Allah will ask us, has Nuh conveyed the message? Has Musa conveyed the message? Has Isa conveyed his message to his people? Has Ibrahim conveyed his message to people? And this ummah will say, Ya Allah, we witness that they have all conveyed the message. Allahu Akbar. We will bear witness on behalf of the Anbiya. We will say, Ya Allah, this Anbiya has conveyed the message. This is the meaning of what? جَعَلْنَاكُمْ مَتَوَسَلْتَكُمْ شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. We are witness over the people on Yawm al-Qiyamah that all their Anbiya and their Rusul have conveyed the message to their people. The question I ask now is, we never lived to see this. We are the last of the Ummah, am I right? Huh? So the question is, how can we witness to something that we haven't seen? You are the last of the nation. You can only witness. Did you witness to the marriage of your father and mother? He's thinking. You were not born, Shaykhana. Allah yadik, unless you are jinn. You are not there. You're not existing. You don't have to think about it. You could not say, I witnessed to the marriage of my mom. The certificate is there, but you were not a witness. You were not there. Huh? Unless you are the non-Muslims. You know the non-Muslims, what they do? What do? The non-Muslims? 7 years old and 6 years are preparing the marriage ceremony of their father and mother. A'udhu billahi min shaytan ar-rajim. They have 6 children and they have not married yet. And they're saying, we are going to get married next year. This is when you leave Islam, this is what happens. When you leave your values, you're going to end up like that. When you remain in this country for a very long time and you don't protect your values, your religion, you don't come to the masajid, you don't go around elders, you learn Islam, you be around good Muslims, this is what will happen to you. This is what will happen. Many of youngsters, Muslims, will have the same sort of, you will see Muslim girls that are married to non-Muslim men, which of course in Islam is haram, as we all know. We know it's haram. And yet it happens. Why? Because of lack of Islam. Lack of Islam. So the question is, how do we witness? What do you guys think? The ulama, I will give you what the shaykh said about this, inshallah. But I want to give you ideas. I want to see your ideas, inshallah. MashaAllah. MashaAllah. Yes. نعم ايه ما شاء الله ما شاء الله with a product of all the other religions. ما شاء الله جزاك الله خيرا. Very good answer, inshallah. Listen to some of the mashayikh said about this, how we are witnessing. They said that we were not there, that's for sure. We were not there. We were not at the time of Nuh alayhi salam. Unless, how old are you? How old was Nuh and his da'wah? Huh? Inna arsalna Nuhan. You haven't read Inna arsalna Nuhan? Hayya la qawmihi? An andir? The what day? Shaky. Mashallah. Okay, they said, we heard it from one. Listen to the words. They said, we heard this message from one whose words are more authentic than what one sees with his own eyes. We've heard this message from one whom his words are more authentic than what you see with your own eyes. Who can explain this? Huh? We heard from Allah, but who brought it up from Allah? Allah didn't speak to us directly. Who? Who's this one that we're referring to here? Rasulullah alayhi salatu wassalam. As-sadiq al-mastuq. Rasulullah in huwa illa wahyun yuha. He only speaks out of what? Revelations. We heard it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He told us that all the anbiya has conveyed their message to their people. We heard this from a messenger whom his words are more authentic. This is the one that I want you to underline. More authentic than what? Than seeing with your eyes. The words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the heart of the believer should be more authentic than what you actually see with your eyes. Yes or no? Have you seen Jannah? How do you know Jannah exists? Huh? Quran. From the Quran, from the words of Allah. Through who? Through the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ilm al-yaqeen that the brother was talking about. You have certainty. Like Abu Bakr Siddiq. Huh? How did he earn this title? Anyone who knows? Huh? Fighting Mahad Kaddaniyo. No fighting. As-Siddiq. What's As-Siddiq? Honesty? No. Close. Siddiq. Siddiq. Akhi. The truthful. The truthful. As-Siddiq is the one who believes. Who believes? When did he end this title, Akhi? Can you share with us, inshallah? Mata had a laqab. How did he become a Siddiq? Yes. As-sakinat alayhi. Yes. Yes. Yeah. That's the he's, yeah. One surah, yeah. MashaAllah. He was very close to Rasulullah Sallam. Barakallahu feek. Akhir Fadl. Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. Aha. Ikaid Murka. Post for me there. What is Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj? Oh, how can I get how quick? I got the message. الإسراء والمعراج قرر ما يزيد هيا هوي ماونتن هاي كطالة الإسراء والمعراج أسوأ دويس ما شاء الله ما شاء الله هاي حسين الإسراء والمعراج هيا الإسراء والمعراج زكريا ها دي أسنشن يس الإسراء والمعراج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم went from مدينة ما مدينة ما سوري From Makkah, Makkah al-Mukarram, yes? He went from Makkah all the way to Masjid al-Aqsa. So Mahdi, the story when Salah was obligated to us, Salah was obligated through this journey. So it's a journey Rasulullah ﷺ did from where? From Makkah all the way to Masjid al-Aqsa, which is in where? In Palestine, mashallah. Alhamdulillah, I didn't hear the other name. In Masjid al-Aqsa. And from Masjid al-Aqsa, Allah took him to where? This is called al-Isra. What is al-Mi'raj? Akhi, al-Mi'raj? The journey from where? From Masjid al-Aqsa to where? Can't you go there? Follow my hand up, yes. To heaven. To heaven, Allah elevated Rasulullah s.a.w. in body and soul. In body and soul, Allah took him one night. One night. The journey from Mecca all the way to Masjid al-Aqsa. And then from Masjid al-Aqsa all the way to the seven heavens. And each of these he met the Malaika and he met the Anbiya. Yes? And the Salah was obligated to him. Yes or no? And how many Salah was obligated? 20 Maha. Huh? 5,000 Mai. Subhatu Mashaykh. ما 50 صلاة بهد صباحي 50 بهد And then it got reduced. Anyway, this journey, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the Quraysh, when they heard that Muhammad alayhi salam was claiming that he went for a journey over one night from Mecca to Masjid al-Aqsa and from Masjid al-Aqsa to the seven heavens and then back to Masjid al-Aqsa and then back to Mecca within the same night. The people of Quraysh said, oh, this is an opportunity for us. All the Muslims will not believe in Muhammad anymore because they knew that this journey was impossible. Al-Buraq, yes, he was taken, mashallah. Jazakallah khair. So what happened is, they used it as an opportunity. So they wanted to turn the Muslims against him. So they went to his closest friend. And who's his closest friend, as the brother told us? Abu Bakr was his closest friend and best companion. They said, this is the chance to turn Abu Bakr against him. They said to Abu Bakr, oh Abu Bakr, have you heard Sahibaka, your friend, have you heard what he's saying? Abu Bakr said, what did he say? They said, he is claiming that he went from Mecca to Masjid al-Aqsa. And what's even more crazy than that is that he went from there to the seven heavens. And then he came back and he led the Anbiya in Salah. And then he returned back within the same night. They all paused to see the reply of Abu Bakr. To see what Abu Bakr would say, let me go ask him. Is it possible? Are you sure he said it? How long is the distance between Aqsa and he didn't do none of this stuff. What did he say? In kana qalahu. If he said so, he said, you are telling me the news. I'm not sure. You are the ones who conveyed the message to me. But if you are telling me the truth and he said it, then it is the way he said it. Look at the yaqeen. Look at the iman, level of iman. The level of iman, Allah, Rasulullah said, he said, khalas, I'm not going to question it. I'm not going to put it to logic. My brain is not able to comprehend it. But I know that this is wahi. He's revealing out of revelation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-qawi, al-aziz, the most strongest. Allah can do anything he wants to do. Yes or no? Akhi, fadal. MashaAllah. MashaAllah. He said, I believe in something that's even more amazing than this. Which is what? He said, he brought me the Quran, Suma. He said, he brought me the wahi. He's telling me that he's a prophet of Allah. That he's a representative of Allah. That there's a revelation that is coming to him. I believe in this. Do you think I'm not going to believe in him telling me that he made a journey? I believe in him that he is telling that he knows of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He brought Islam to me. So that is how the Muslim's iman should be. When Rasulullah says to you that if you come to the salah, you get such amount of reward, you should have yaqeen that this reward is there awaiting for yawm al-qiyamah. Your level of iman should be so strong. But the problem of us as human beings is that we only value what we see. We only value what we touch. We only value what I can get today and not tomorrow. Am I right or wrong? We value what I can get now. We are in ajal. We're always in hasten. We value what I can get today and not tomorrow. So there's so many ahadith that tell us about the reward of coming to the masjid. So many rewards about praying Salatul Fajr on time. So many rewards about following the sunnah. We all know this. But is our life in line with what we know? Is our life, the way we live our life, is it in line? Is it in agreement with what we know of Islam? No. We always live opposite what we know, isn't it? We know the Jannah is true. We know death is very close. You know I can die any second. Yet our life contradicts Islam. Contradicts what I know. I'm always against what I know that Islam is. Because we can't wait. We want something quick. So we need to wake up, inshallah ta'ala. So we are ummatan wasata. The best and most excellent ummah. Secondly, we are what? Shuhada'a ala nasi. Is it befitting for that person to be a follower or a leader? Tell me. Speak up, guys. Followers or leaders? Leaders. They should follow your fashion, man. Tomorrow you should go to the masjid, to your school with khamis. And inshallah, hopefully everyone will follow you. It's a fashion. I remember, wallah. Watch, if you are strong in what you do, they will follow your trend. Everything becomes fashion. Now the beard is fashion. You see many people growing beard, non-Muslims. You don't know who's Muslim or non-Muslim now. They're all growing beard. The non-Muslims are saying, we want to go back to our masculinity. We want to become a man. Have you seen those guys? There are men who when they read the history, and they read the history of their ancestors, and they find out that women should be working the house, and man is... Some men are saying, I've seen them in workplaces. They're always against this femininity movement. And they say, oh, we have masculinity. Oh, what, how's masculinity? He always grows beard. Look at the appearance. And the Muslim is ashamed. Every day he's buying a razor. Finished all his money. Miskin. 2 days you shave and next day your beard is grown again. Yes or no? Oh, mashallah. Yeah. Save yourself money. Huh? Leave this honor, mashallah. Leave it to grow. Be aziz of who you are. Yes? Be proud of who you are. And Roma told me many times, you will be rewarded more at times of difficulties when you are gharib, when you are a stranger. When you practice Islam in the West, you are more rewarded in the eyes of Allah than the youngsters who practice Islam in the Muslim countries. Because for them, everything is easy. For them, to pray is the norm. For you, you have to come out of the comfort of your house. You have to catch the bus. You have to fight the tradition around you. Maybe in your household, most of the people are not praying, and you're the one who's praying salah. The more you start practicing and you are unique, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you and rewards you more. Okay? You have to be proud of Islam. Be proud of who you are. Don't be photocopies. Have your hair, cut your hair like me, number one. Huh? Very easy. What happens if you grow like Hali Habasha? This is when you grow and they put the afro, and then they put the comb on top like this. Huh? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. One of them, I've seen him in the madrasa, without naming names. He has this, akramakumullah, you know this brush that you brush your shoes with? He was, wallahi, I thought it's for the shoes. He has a brush that looks like the one that I brush my shoes with it. I said, what's this for? He said, it's for my hair, ma'alim. I said, la hawla wa la quwwata illa. And where's the mirror then? Next time you bring the mirror as well in your bag, like the girls. Because the girls are the ones who always carry what? They carry mirrors every time, they're watching their hair, they're this and that. If the men, my boys behave like that, what's the difference? Waver, Nguli. Simply, Ashaykh Khala, one number one. Ma'asalam. Don't pretend. Don't imitate other people. Be proud of who you are. Be unique, stand out. The reason I told my son, I was telling him, even let's say for the sake of argument, Ma'alin, there's nothing wrong with this. Fine. There's nothing wrong with it, but you are giving an example. You are attracting the wrong crowd. You are attracting who? The wrong crowd. Those boys, the gangsters, those drug dealers, they will not approach you when they see that you're cutting number one. Am I right or wrong? Am I lying? They look at appearance. When you dress like them, when you look like them, when you cut your hairstyle like them, then they will feel that you are one of them. They'll try to attract you towards them. So if you want to be protected, and you want to protect your Islam, and you want those drug dealers to stay away from you, be different to their fashion. They will not approach you. So this is even a prevention. It's a protection for you. Be different. Okay? Islam has bigger issues to worry about than their hair. We have bigger issues to worry about than your dress. It's good to look clean. It's good, of course, Islam, as we will see, inshallah ta'ala, purity, al-tahara, is from Islam. Purity and being clean and being tidy. Inna Allah jameel. Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. There's nothing wrong in us dressing nice and looking nice and ironing my clothes. Don't get the wrong message. Don't go to school tomorrow with your shirt unironed. Because Ma'alim said I got to be rough. No, don't be rough. Not to that extent. Balance. Ummatan, wasata, balanced. This ummah is balanced between extreme. You don't go to the extreme, don't go to the extreme. Be in the middle. Dress like who? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look like him, walk like him, sleep like him, eat like him. Everything that he did, you do. Even though if you don't understand the wisdom behind it. Even though you don't understand. In a hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to drink with his right hand. And he used to drink 3 zips. And he used to put it down. He used to do Bismillah. And he used to put it down. Do I know the wisdom behind it? No. Who did it? Rasulullah. There is barakah in this. If I do it, I'll get ajr for it. Tomorrow, after 10, 20 years, they will discover some scientific benefits for it. That's up to you. It's too late for me. Alhamdulillah, I've earned all the science. Allah looked after me. You don't have to have science to prove everything for me. Everything that now science is proving is from Islam. But as a Muslim, you accept. Yes, it came from Rasulullah. It came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Alim, Al-Hakim, the most wise, the most knowing. Who knows what's good for me? Who knows what's harmful for me? Allah says, don't listen to music. Allah knows why. Allah says, don't have girlfriends. Allah knows why. It's haram. Look after your body. Allah says so. Eat from the pure. Allah said so. Be fit and strong. Allah said so. Everything that's positive, Islam encourages. So we need to learn, change our mentality. Islam is not a backward religion. Islam has solutions to everything. The only problem is with his followers. The problem is not with the message. The problem is with who? You and I. The problem is with you and I. When we don't practice Islam, Islam is beautiful religion and the best religion and the most complete religion. And it will only be mukarram. Allah has honored it with us or without us. We should be honored to carry Islam. Islam is already honored. Yes or no? Allah has promised for Islam. For this religion to reach east and west. Allah has promised it. With you or without you. If you sleep and you're busy with your, what's it called? With these two thumbs. Huh? PlayStation. Isha Shagma Al Usba. Xbox, mashallah. These things I don't know. Huh? Snapchat. If you are busy with this, Islam, where is Islam? Islam will go forward. You will be the one who's lost. Allah doesn't need you. Allah does not need us. Allah will replace us with people. Yes? Better than us. Our time will come. We will die. We will go in the graves. And we will be standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will bring for this religion people that will carry this religion and bring it back to its dignity and its honor, like the Sahaba radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhim, we saw before. From what life did Allah move them to what life? We saw it. We saw what kind of life they lived before Islam. And we saw what Umar said. I keep drilling the words of Umar. Who remembers the words of Umar? I keep drilling because it's important to us. You were with us last week? You know it, akhi. Yeah. Yaga. They were here last week. What did Umar say? That's the problem of not writing down. I told you, either you guys are like Imam Bukhari, and you have, mashallah, very strong memory, I will excuse you not to write. Or you are either like me, you can't remember anything. By the time you walk out of that door, you forgot everything. And the solution to that is what? The pen. Al-Qalam, Ummat Al-Qalam, where are you guys? Where's the pen? No one is taking note. Either you are like Bukhari, you have very strong, mashallah, memory, may Allah give you barakah, or you have a pen. One of those two solutions. From next week, inshallah, you have to choose one of those two. So tell me, do you remember what Umar said? Huh? He wasn't there last week. Ah, Zakaria, I know you were there. Ah. Everybody's not there last week now, suddenly. Ah, Hussein, what did Umar say last week? Allah give you barakah. Guys, you have to revise your notes, otherwise there's no. Ah. MashaAllah, yes, very good. Jazakallah khair. Yes, akhi, fadal akhi. Zakaria. Yes, but I want the statements of Umar. These were examples. Barakallahu fiqh, it's not wrong. But I want the statement of Umar. Adana Allah. Write it down again. Write it, Qura. Huh? I will repeat it, inshallah. Write it down. نحن قوم. We are a people. We are a nation, or we are a people. نحن قوم. We are a people, or we are a nation. Before نحن قوم ما قرتين. Allah give us the khair of this wind, inshallah. We are a nation, or we are a group of people. We are a people. We are a people, or we are a nation. أعزنا الله بالإسلام. We are a nation. Allah has honored us by Islam. Allah has honored us by what? Al-Islam. Allah has honored us by Islam. If you don't have pen, write it down on your phones, inshallah. نحن قوم أعزنا الله بالإسلام. We are a people that Allah has honored us by what? Islam. فإن ابتغينا العزة. If we seek honor. If we seek honor in other than Islam. If we seek honor in other than Islam. فإن ابتغينا العزة. If we seek honor in other than Islam. أذلنا الله. Allah will disgrace us. Write these words and remember them and print them, inshallah, in your hearts before you print them in the papers. In your own words, what does that mean? Don't read from the paper. Oh, okay, mashallah. Go ahead. Give an example of what does it mean to you. Personalized. I want personalized. Photocopy. Parrot. Oh, I did Allah. You don't know parrot. Piracy, what piracy? Piracy. Piracy. Yeah. Piracy. Just kidding with you. Pirate, pirate, inshallah. Pirate, keep repeating. Oh, yeah. No brain. Huh? Keep repeating. I want your view. MashaAllah. Qur. Ma pirate, nika wana gisi wana kana. Sheikh. Yeah. MashaAllah, good. These are your own words now. You try to get honor in other than Islam, yes. Then what will happen to you? You're finished. Allah has disgraced you. So you were elevated. Means you came from where? From nothing. Allah has gave you the status of what? Honor, dignity, respect. Yes or no? And I gave you examples in the seerah where people used to kill their children. They used to kill their daughters before Islam. Yes or no? They used to eat anything that they used to kill each other. They used to not respect anyone. But Islam came to them. They were looked down by the super nations. Rome, Furs used to think that they are not even human beings, the Arabs. When they came to them, when the Sahaba came to them to preach them Islam, the Romans and the Persians, they laughed at them. They said to them, you guys were hungry peoples. Go back to where you came from. If you want food, we will give you food. The Sahaba came to them with Islam. They were mocking them. The Romans could not think, and the Furs could not think that these Arabs are coming them to give them Islam. They said, no, listen, you guys were hungry people. You're not actually even human beings. Go back to Arabia. We will send you more food so that you can live. And the Sahaba, radhiallahu ta'ala alayhim, but Sahabi, he said words, I don't want to say it. But it shows you the izzah of the Muslim. Huh? It shows you the izzah of the Muslim. Because he mocked him down, he also mocked him back. The Sahabi, with his honor and dignity, he said, we didn't come for any of that stuff. He said, we heard that the blood of the Romans is very sweet. He wanted to mock him as well back. Of course, nobody's going to drink blood. I'm just. But this is just to show you how the Sahaba, this Sahabi who came to see the Faris king at that time, he was wearing simple clothes. He was dragging his spear on the floor. Huh? He came maybe probably with a donkey. Huh? That's how poor the Sahaba were. But they were Rijal. What were they? Rijal. Rijal. Who's Rijal? Yeah, who's Rijal? What's rijal mean in Arabic? Huh? Brave. Other word. They were men. They were men. Men, not in the sense of your physical appearance. Huh? They were men in value. They were men, the real meaning of man. But this is the izzah that we need to bring back in Islam. Imagine if the Sahaba see our youngsters today, that we are only shy and we're hiding with Islam, and if I want to go pray, I go near the toilets, I find a small corner and I hide in there, I don't want my friends to see me pray salah. And you know what? Imagine if the Sahaba saw this, that you're embarrassed to pray salah and to tell people about Islam and to tell your teacher that I have to go and pray salah and to stand up to your teachers and explain, of course, in a respectful manner. I'm not saying to be disrespectful. No, Islam does not teach you to be disrespectful. Islam teaches you to respect others. But be proud of who you are. Don't hide your faith. How can you hide this light that Allah has given you? You are supposed to share this Iman, this Islam with others. So if you are hiding who your identity, you're hiding who you are, there will be no day you will stand up on your feet and call people to Islam. You're supposed to give her da'wah. Yes or no? Yes or no? Barakallahu fikum. All of you have to become du'at. Call to Islam. That's the only mission that we have in this country. Am I right? The ulama, they say, it is not allowed for the Muslim to live in the lands of the non-Muslims except for the following reasons. Listen carefully. It is not halal for the Muslim to live in the lands of the non-Muslims except for the following reasons. One, sickness. He's very ill. He can't find doctors that are specialized in his illness in the Muslim countries. The only place he can find them is where? In the non-Muslim countries. He come here, he seeks medicine, he gets well, and then he goes back where? Back to his Muslim country. That's one reason. For medicine reasons, medical reasons, you're sick. Your mom is sick. You brought her for that reason. Two. What's the second reason you guys think? Visiting family, what's your two? It's good, mashallah. What's your two, Shaykhana? What's your two holiday? Holiday, you go to Mecca. Go do tawaf in the haram. You want holiday? Huh? Go do tawaf. Go where there is green, ya Sheikh. Go to the Muslim countries. There's siyaha everywhere. You don't have to come here. Second reason, the only other reason is what? Da'wah. Barakallah. Yes, akhi, da'wah is? Financial reasons. But financial as well, akhi, the ulama don't consider it. They only consider one. We mentioned, what is it? Sickness. Two, fear. You run with your life. Like many Muslim countries, they're in danger. They can't live their life. The only way they can live. The other Muslim countries are not allowing them to go in. No other Muslim country is welcoming them. The only option they have is to come to the Britain or to go to other places. They are allowed. So for fear of their life, fear of their properties, fear of their children, and so on. That's second reason. Third reason is the ulama, they say, ilm, to learn knowledge which the Muslim countries don't have. Yeah? If there's, like for example, there are courses which the Muslim countries don't have, or specialties that only you can learn in this country, then you come here to learn and then to go back. And the last reason that we mentioned is the issue of what? Da'wah. You come here to preach Islam. So you're one of these. If you're not one of these, you're committing a sin, according to some of the scholars. Just to be fair, according to some of the scholars. I will not say all, because then I will be lying. According to some of the scholars, you are committing a sin. Otherwise, you have to be in one of these folds. That means you have to be... What's the only option we have? What's the only option for us now? Of these four that I mentioned. Are we all sick? No. Are we here for education that we can't find in Muslim countries? Maybe. What are we here for? Da'wah. Da'wah. But how can you give da'wah if you don't know Islam? You have to know Islam. How can you give da'wah if you're not unique and you're not proud of who you are and you can't show Islam and you're always hiding? You can't show Islam. So number one, be proud of your Islam. Learn the beauty of the religion that you have. Don't be like the one who has a diamond, who does not know the value of what he has. Yes? Barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullahu khayran. Dua al-majlis. The dua of the majlis that we read last week. Subhanakallahumma. Aha. MashaAllah. Barakallahu feekum. I told you to learn last week. Say again. Subhanakallahumma. وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. جزاكم الله خيرا. Hopefully inshallah we'll see you next week inshallah. Don't leave for Isha. We have only a few minutes left for Isha, so don't disappear inshallah. If you have time, pray. If you're in rush, then inshallah khair inshallah. We'll see you next week inshallah if you're in rush. See you all inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Guys in WhatsApp, Zoom, I'll see you all inshallah, hopefully as well next week. Jazakum Allah khair for being very patient. And inshallah, next week inshallah, barakallahu fiik fadl, ayah fadl shaykh, du'aakum inshallah. Next week inshallah, ba'd salat al-maghrib, so hopefully we become about 6 I think, or yeah, hopefully about 5:45 or 5:50 or 6, depending on what time we finish salah, and depending on what time the imam finishes the salah inshallah. So I'll see you all inshallah next week. Assalamu alaikum. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.